Hello, I'm Pastor Scott, and welcome to worship here with Sanctuary, a safe place to explore faith. On Facebook this week, people shared about the sweetest compliment that they have received. And I want to highlight just one particular comment that really touched me. It was from a woman who shared about a time that her daughter was in the hospital, and her daughter was getting major surgery, and she was dedicated. She stayed there, right there with her daughter from the time she was admitted till the time she was discharged. And in addition, the surgeon who did the surgery did an amazing technical job with the surgery. And she was, of course, wonderfully and immensely grateful for that. But the surgeon also took the time to acknowledge her and acknowledge the strong presence that she had there with her daughter. And this speaks to me in several ways about how people love one another. At first, this woman was demonstrating her love for her daughter by being there in the way that she was. Hearing and feeling expressions of love serve to motivate us, encourage us, and strengthen us, help us to know that we're not alone. But then beyond that, that comment from the surgeon spoke to her and told her that she was seen. That also speaks of the kind of love that people have between one another. Now, since Easter, we've been talking about what Jesus' resurrection means in our lives. And today we're talking about love. There are literally passages in the Bible from the beginning to the end that talk about love. A lot of it talking about God's love, but also about the love that we have for one another. Everything else could be stripped away. All the doctrine, all the organizations, churches, laws, all of it could be all wiped away. But one thing would remain. And that is love. Probably more than anything else, the life of faith in Jesus could be one described as living inside love. The author of a letter called 1 John wrote about the essence of God and went as far as to say that God is love. The Apostle Paul wrote about love throughout so many of his letters. And one, he talked about how faith, hope, and love were so central to living in community with Jesus at the center. And he said that when it comes down to it, love is the overarching umbrella under which everything else in life fits. Now, he wrote the following passage to a group of house churches in a city called Corinth. I invite you to listen.
A reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 1 through 8a. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends.
I invite you to pray with me. Loving God, today we come together in worship, desiring to love more fully, to love more like you. And we know that this is done imperfectly by us all the time. At times we do things that are not motivated by love, but by our own selfish interests, fear that rises up inside of us, perhaps pride or some other kind of vice that we have. We pray, God, that you would help us to accept your forgiveness and return to love. In your name, God, we pray. Amen.
Let love lead.
Let God lead.
Let love lead. when the cares of our lives begin and end with the hurt of others. Yeah, we begin to breathe when the wounds of others become relieved with the love of others. Oh. He who looks around to find who's in need has made the best investment as a human being. You know that he who looks around to find who's in need has made the best investment in his legacy. I say that love will never force, love will never quit, love ain't never lose, and love ain't never miss. Of all things lasting, there remains only three. For money can't buy, only these will succeed. Faith, hope, and love, the greatest of these is love. So here is a formula for situation. Just let God and let love lead the way. Oh, let love lead.
Let God lead.
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 Can love strut?
No way.
Can love destroy?
No way.
Does love a little? Oh, not that way, no, no. Can love close?
No way.
Or be proud?
No way.
Can love rejoice when a mother cries? Love stands up, not just one. Love prevails, and with that one. Love puts up with anything, cause God is love, and love is God. All things lasting, there remains only three. The money can't buy, only these will succeed. Faith, hope, and love, the greatest of these is love. Here is a formula for every hard situation. Just let God and let love lead the way. Oh, oh, oh. Let love lead.
Let God lead.
Let love lead.
Let God lead.
I said, God, let love lead.
Let God lead.
Let love lead.
Let God lead.
God is love.
I definitely want to get back to what we heard earlier from the Apostle Paul and the passage you heard. But there's another passage in the Bible written by John, one of Jesus's closest friends. And I'd like to spend some time with this. It's in the 17th chapter of John's book. And it's the longest prayer attributed to Jesus in the Bible that's recorded. And in this passage, Jesus has come to the completion of his work of ministry and is heading toward the cross. And at this moment, he's celebrating truly the work that has been done. It's completed. Those of you who have had the completion of a job that's been long and involved and difficult at points, maybe you can understand the relief, perhaps. And yet, there's more work to be done, of course, for him on the cross. But he's asking God here to glorify him because of the work that's been done. And he's also asking that the work of building God's kingdom in this world might continue through those who had already committed themselves to that path, but then also to those who someday might commit themselves to that path. Now, it's likely that John included this very intimate prayer of Jesus in his book because it can also be the prayer of this growing church community throughout time into the future. In other words, it can truly be our prayer as well. It can provide us, even today, some 2,000 years later, a focus for what is important in a faith-filled life. I invite you to listen to a portion of Jesus' prayer.
The next reading is from John chapter 17, verses 6 through 20. I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you. For the words that you gave to me, I have given to them, and they have received them and know the truth that I came from you. And they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, all yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one, as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them in your name that you had given me. I guarded them, and not one of them was lost, except the one destined to be lost, so that the scripture might be fulfilled. But now I am coming to you, and I speak these things in the world, so that they may have my joy complete in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. I am not asking you to take them out of the world, but I ask you to protect them from the evil one. They do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. Sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. As you have sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. And for their sakes, I sanctify myself, so that they may also be sanctified in truth. I ask not only on behalf of these, but also on behalf of those who will believe in me through their word, that they may all be one. As you, Father, are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me.
Now, like I said earlier, we're talking about love today. And while the word love wasn't even actually in that passage that you just heard, in Jesus' prayer, it's pretty clear that love is nonetheless the very context of the prayer. We can hear it in between the words and even driving the words with the emotion that we can imagine is behind it. Jesus clearly loves the community of people he had been living his life with for several years of time. But you know what? The rub is that he knows he is going to be leaving them very soon. I'm sure that is painful for him. So at the same time that he feels this great love, he also feels this great grief, knowing that he won't be with them much longer. You know, and in this prayer, Jesus is truly passing the baton to the next generation that they might pick up the work that he had committed his life to and simply run with it. And Jesus knows something at this point that they will only come to know later, and that that they will actually not be able to do this kind of work on their own. Carrying on this kind of legacy of love will take being empowered by and being fueled by the power of God's Spirit. But I get ahead of myself. That actually comes next week. Stay tuned. In this powerful prayer, though, we get a glimpse of Jesus' heart. Now, it's clear that love, and much beyond a simple emotion, this love is the primary foundation of Jesus' relationship with God and also with his closest friends. He knows that it will also be the foundation of God's growing community forever after this point. And in this way, perhaps we can also feel this love of God stretch through time and include us as well. And we can almost feel ourselves a part of that prayer that Jesus is praying. Now, I want to go back to the passage that you heard earlier from the Apostle Paul. This is part of perhaps the most commonly read passage for weddings. You know, this is when people want to talk about love binding two people together. And absolutely, love certainly does this, but it actually does so much more. It's what binds communities of people together when everything else seems to fail or fall apart. It's what is left when nothing else can survive. Paul was writing to the people in Corinth because the very foundation of their lives and community was so different than their prior life had been before encountering Jesus. they had courageously created a community with love as its heartbeat. Their community was inclusive in unconventional ways. It was self-sacrificial in unpredictable ways, and it was revolutionary in risky ways. Everything else, Paul says, can be stripped away in life, but love will always remain. You see, no government, no individual person, no power, or anything else that we can imagine can take away or overcome the power of love. In particular, God's love for us, but also then our love for one another. Now, there's a pastor named Dr. Jackie Lewis, and she pastors a church called the Middle Collegiate Church in the East Village of Manhattan in New York City. Now, some of us from this congregation, Sanctuary, actually met Pastor Jackie when we attended a conference a few years back in Atlanta. The church that Jackie pastors was the very first nonprofit institution in this country. their number, I think, was 0000001. The very first a nonprofit organization in this country. And that congregation has a long and vibrant history of social justice and working so hard to stand with and for those who are on the margins within their neighborhood. But 5 months ago, during the middle of this COVID pandemic, on Saturday, December 5th, 2020, their 128-year-old church building burned down. It was tragic, and it was totally devastating for that whole congregation and even the community that surrounded it. And this really moved me as well, because I experienced that as well in a prior church that I served. I remember standing there in disbelief, watching this building that so much ministry had happened and so many groups from the community had met there and had called it their home. And we were watching it burning from the parking lot. I can only imagine what it was like for Pastor Jackie and her congregation. Back in March 2020, Middle Church, just like Sanctuary here in Birmingham, Michigan, had doubled down with the online worship experience. But unlike us, they actually have no idea when they'll be able to worship again in person. And yet, what they declared on December 5th, 2020, and they actually still declare today, is that no fire can stop revolutionary love. Middle Church has reasserted their mission in the world and continue to demonstrate love by doing things such as canceling debt and mortgage debt, like rental debt and mortgage debt for people so that they can stay in the homes where they currently live. And since December 5th, they have been also showing love by helping people get vaccinated. They're showing love by dedicating resources to help stop violence against Asian Americans. And they're also funding the efforts of the Black Lives Matter movement and so much more. Middle Church is one example of how nothing can stop the power of love in this world. You know, Jesus passed on a powerful legacy to those 12 people that he surrounded himself with and with whom he shared intimate conversations over pita bread and hummus. We have also inherited that same legacy of love. May we carry on that legacy of love and, like Jesus, pass it on now to the next generation, that they also might carry it proudly and bravely into the future for next generations to come. I invite you to pray with me. Loving God, we have inherited a legacy passed on to us from our mothers and fathers in faith. We know that they received it from others before them and so on, all the way back to Jesus. And we thank you for this long and powerful legacy of love that comes to us and is placed in our hands. We know, God, that it's our job to carry this legacy and pass it on to others, that their lives might also be enriched and undergirded and empowered by love. Dear God, show us how to best carry and pass along this kind of baton. In your name we pray. Amen.
Lord, we don't need another mountain. There are mountains and hillsides enough to climb. There are oceans and rivers enough to cross, enough to last. till the end of time. What the world needs now is love sweet enough. It's the only thing that there's just short of love.
Now may each of you find a safe place to be filled with hope. May you have the courage to do what is good. May you walk with those who are weary, support those who are weak, help those who are sick and in pain. May you love and serve those who need you and honor everyone. And while rejoicing in the blessings of each day as God provides, in the name of the lover, the beloved, and love itself, go with courage, go with heart, and go in peace. Amen. And remember, we will get through this together.
Thank you. Thank you.